I'm talking about computational imaging with randomness. And actually, computational imaging with randomness has been done by Professor Brady here, for example, Kelsey. But it would be nice if I can show you some slightly different perspective of this topic today. This is after my talk. First, I'd like to remind you what computational imaging is. And in conventional imaging, we use image optics to observe the object information to the image itself. And in this case, the captured image is similar to the original one. On the other hand, in the case of computational imaging, we do not use imaging optics anymore. We use coding optics to project the object information to the image sensor. And in this case, the captured image is quite different from the original one, but we can apply a reconstruction process in the computer, and then we can recover the original image from the captured one. And by using this computational imaging framework, we can enhance or increase the frame rate or I should say throughput of the imaging systems, and also we can simplify the optical setup. And next I'll talk about learning-based computational imaging. In the case of learning-based computational imaging, we use a machine learning algorithm in the computational process. And today I'll talk about several examples of learning-based computational imaging. And the first example is imaging processing in media. And you may know many kinds of scattered media. For example, biological tissue, atmospheric turbulence, user hole, and so on. And we want to see inside of or behind those scattered media. And this is our optical setup. In this case, our target is a special light modulator, SLM. And the SLM, a special light modulator, is located between two diffusers. And the first diffuser is unique with coherent light. And scattered light from the second diffuser is captured with the image sensor, without lenses. In this case, the optical process is random because the two diffusers are inserted in the optical path. And furthermore, we use coherent light to illuminate the diffuser. And in this case, the optical process is linear for complex amplitude. On the other hand, image sensors just observe intensity only, and they do not observe the phase of the light wave. So, and we do not use reference light, then our measurement is intensity only. Then, this measurement process is also non-linear. And in this study, we want to estimate an image displayed on spatial light modulator from the spectral intensity of the image sensor. But again, this process is random and nonlinear, so it is not so easy. So we use a machine learning approach. And in this case, first we display an image on the spatial light modulator, and we observe spectral intensity from it on the image sensor. And then we change an image on the spatial light modulator and we capture the spectrum again. And then we change the spectrum again and we capture it again. And then we can, this process is repeated many times, and we observe a large number of input and output pairs. And then we calculate the inverse function from image sensor to the spatial light modulator, based on the regression. And the regression is a typical technique in machine learning, for example, support vector machine, deep learning, and so on. And by using a regression, we can calculate a hyperplane, which minimizes the error between the hyperplane and those sampling points. So, okay, I'll show our experimental demonstration. And first, we prepare 4,000 training pairs of objects and speckles. And for example, this speckle is from this object displayed on the spatial light modulator, and this speckle is from this prepare 100 test pairs of objects and specules. And those test pairs are not included in the frame dataset. And then we calculate the inverse function with the frame dataset. And then we calculate the inverse function is applied to the specule in the test dataset. And this is the result. So we could estimate the object image between the accusers. Next, I'll talk about object classification. Again, we could estimate the object through the scattering media. So in this case, how can we classify the object in the scattering media? For example, we can have this approach. And this is an object, and this is a diffuser, and this is a specular. And we can estimate this object image from the specular by using our method, or we can data method too. And then we can classify the reconstructed image. And this process is okay, but in this case, the reconstruction process may be computationally expensive. So we remove the reconstruction process and we directly run the specular and then classify the specular. Okay, so I'll show our experimental demonstration. And in this demonstration, we performed classification of specules from face or non-face images. And these are examples of face objects, and these are specules from them. And these are examples of non-face images, and these are specules from them. And we used 2,000 images for training and 200 images for this. And the classification address was 90%. Next, I'll talk about orthocytometry. And orthocytometry is inspired by ghost imaging. And this is a typical setup of ghost imaging. And in ghost imaging, object is eliminated with random distortion pattern from the special light detector. And light from the object is captured with a single pixel detector, not an image sensor. And then the random pattern from the special light detector is changed, and light from the object is captured with the single pixel detector. And then the random pattern is changed again, and light from the object is captured with the single pixel detector. This process is repeated many times, and then we can recover the object image from the visual signals. So in ghost imaging, we do not need any image sensor for imaging. So this is a very interesting concept. And then various methods for ghost imaging will be proposed and also demonstrated. However, the throughput of ghost imaging is severely limited by the frame rate of the special light modulator for random pattern projection. Okay, so I will talk about ghost cytometry. And this is a collaborative work with Professor Sadamoto in the University of Tokyo. And this is the static diagram of ghost cytometry. And in ghost cytometry, we implemented random pattern on the macroscopic channel. And this optical pattern is static and fixed, so we do not change this optical pattern. And this is the difference from the conventional ghost image. And when the cell is passing through the first pattern, a fluorescent light is excited from the cell with the first pattern, and the fluorescent light from the self captured with the single pixel detector, like post image. And we call this major signal post signal. And the cell flows, we observe post signal. Cell flows, we observe post signal. And if different cell is coming to the pattern, we observe different post signal. And we can recover the cell image from the process signal by using a construction algorithm in ghost image. But as I mentioned in the previous topic, which is about classification with scattering media, the reconstruction process is computationally expensive. So we remove the reconstruction process and we directly learn the process signal and directly classify the ghost signal without reconstruction. And if the ghost signal is from target cell, a pulse is generated and the cell is stopped. So in ghost imaging, the cell classification and the cell sorting are performed by using image information of the cell. But there is no cell image in this computational pipeline. So this is the key how we increase the throughput of cell classification and cell sorting in cross-cycle. And we demonstrated several examples. And today I will show you a classification of LCF7 and LCF2. And they are cells, and they have similar morphologies. I cannot distinguish them, but both cytology can do. And the classification accuracy was 0.971, which is based on area under the log curve. And the classification throughput was 10 cells per second. And the sorting throughput was 3,000 cells per second. And as I mentioned, we can recover the cell image from the ghost signal. And these are examples of reconstructed images from the ghost signals of MCF7 at 2 fluorescent channel. And in this case, we used our compressive sensing algorithm for the construction. Next, I'll talk about control. And the first example is focusing on the scattering media. And this is the optical setup of focusing on the scattering media. And actually, this optical setup is really similar to the imaging of the scattering media in the first topic. And in the case of imaging of the scattering media, we want to estimate the object image displayed on the special light projector from the spectral intensity. And in the case of focusing through scattering media, we want to realize arbitrary focusing pattern on the image sensor by controlling an image spread on the spatial light projector. So they are different, but they are similar. And also the approaches are similar. And in this case, first we display an image on the spatial light projector. And then spectral intensity on the image sensor is captured. And then we change the display image on the spatial light monitor, and we capture the scattered light on the diffuser on the image sensor. Then we change the display image on the spatial light monitor, and we capture it. And this process is repeated many, many times. And then we calculate the inverse function from the image sensor to the specialized monitor with observed training data set. And if we want to realize this target out pattern on the image sensor, the inverse function is applied to this target out pattern. And we generated this input pattern. And this input pattern is displayed on the specialized monitor, and we experimentally observe this output pattern on the image sensor through scattering media. Gagarin shows several examples. These are target dog automatons, and these are estimated input patterns for them. And these estimated input patterns are displayed on a special light moderator. And these are experimental examples of patterns. First can take media. And as you can see, the focusing spot is diagonally scanned, like target dog patterns. And the focusing spot is diffraction limited. And we can extend this concept to multi-spot focusing easily. And these are target dog patterns. And these are estimated input patterns from them. And these input patterns are displayed on special light moderator. And we observe these output patterns. And you can see they are corresponding to the target output patterns. And also the response is diffraction input. Next, I'll talk about computer-generated topograph. And this is the optical setup for focusing through scattering media. And in the case of computer-generated topography, we remove the diffuser. And then, in the case of computer-generated topography, we want to realize arbitrary optical field on the image sensor by controlling an image displayed on a special light object. So actually, this problem is easier than the previous case. But I will show some experimental demonstrations. And in this case, we use the convolutional neural network, which is called the UNET, for the regression. Because optical propagation can be described with the convolutional process. And in UNET, we use a strip connection to increase the optimization speed of the training stage. Okay, so I will show experimental demonstration. First, we demonstrated single spot focusing. And this is a program generated with convolutional neural network. You can see sort of friendly. And this program is displayed on a special light computer. And this is the reproduced image. So we achieved the single spot focusing with this method. And also we performed different examples. These are target patterns, and these are programs with conversion method. And these are programs with calculated with GS method. And which is a very famous algorithm for computer-generated topography. And these are reproduced patterns with conversion network, and these are reproduced patterns with GS method. So they are comparable. Okay, so next I'll talk about non-learning-based computational regression with randomness. And the first example is vision through scattering media. And here I'll talk about spectral correlation imaging. And spectral correlation imaging is a non-invasive method for imaging through scattering media. So in this case, you do not have to access behind or inside of scattering media. And in spectral correlation imaging, we suppose the shift invariance of spectrum. For example, this is an object, and this is the spectral response, and this is the captured image. And in this case, if object is shifted, spectral is shifted. And this shift invariance of spectral is called memory effect. And in spectral correlation imaging, we take a if the object is composed of two point sources, the captured image is the evolution of the object and the first response based on the memory. And in the spectral correlation imaging, we take an autocorrelation of the captured image. And the autocorrelation of the captured image can be approximated as the autocorrelation of the object, because we do not know the spectral response, but we know it is random. And the autocorrelation of the random pattern is delta function. So then the autocorrelation of the captured image is the convolution of the autocorrelation of the object and the delta function. So by taking the autocorrelation of the captured image, we can remove the impact of the spectral on the captured image. So this is a very beautiful idea. But by taking the autocorrelation of the captured image, we lose the phase of the Fourier spectrum of the captured image. Then we apply a phase retrieval algorithm to recover the phase of the Fourier spectrum of the captured image. And we can estimate the object image from the spectrum. And also, actual memory has been reported. And in this case, these axes are green. And also, the spectral response is like our form in this case. So, if the object is actually scanned, the spectral is a scale. Spectral is a scale. So, this is the actual memory. And we use this actual memory to extend the spectral correlation meaning to make minimum this. And this is our optical setup. And this is an object. And this object is located between two diffusers. And we use especially coherent light to illuminate the first diffuser. The scattered light in the diffuser is captured with the emission sensor without lenses. And also, the image sensor is actually scanned to observe three-dimensional spectrum. And this is the measured three-dimensional spectrum. And we take three-dimensional autocorrelation. And then three-dimensional phase retrieval to recover the object three-dimensional. Okay, so I'll show our experimental demonstration. This is our object, which is complicated with a 3D printer. And this object is composed of three layers. First layer, second layer, and third layer. And each layer has differently aligned holes. And this is the captured 3D linear spectrum. Who is actual scanning of the image sensor. And you cannot see any holes. And this is the result of the 3D autocorrelation. You can see something. And this is the result of the 3D phase retrieval. For example, this hole is here, and these two holes are here, and these two holes are here. So we could recover 3D object between the diffusers with non-basic process. So in this case, we need multi-shot method. And next, we extend this concept to single shot case. In this case, we do not need any actual scanning of the image sensor. We just observe single spectral pattern. And this is our measurement, which is a single spectral pattern. And we computationally scale the captured single spectral pattern to emulate actual scanning of the image sensor. And then we take a cross-correlation of the computationally scaled spectral patterns. And then we take the linear phase retrieval as the measured partition approach. Okay, so I'll show our experimental demonstration. This is our object, pretty the same as the previous one. This is the captured image. So we picked a single speckle from the captured 3D mineral speckle in the previous experiment. And you cannot see any more. And we occasionally scale the speckle and we take cross correlation between them. And these are results. And this result are similar to the autocorrelation in the validation approach. And this is the result of 3D mineral phase retrieval. So actually this result is also similar to the previous case. And this hole is here, and these two holes are here, and these two holes are here. So we achieve a single shot 3D mineral imaging through scattering media with non-invasive process. Next, I'll talk about phase imaging. And phase imaging is a useful tool for visualizing transparent target, for example, biological cells. And also, it has been used for wavefront sensing in adaptive optics. And I think the most famous technique for quantitative phase imaging is digital program. And this is the typical optical setup of digital program. In this case, we use the reference light to quantitatively determine the complex sample jet field on the image sensor from the object. But in this case, by introducing the reference light, the optical setup can be large or also complicated. And also, various methods for quantitative phase measurement have been proposed and also demonstrated. However, they have a serious trade-off between the number of shots and the specimen by the product. So basically, to increase the specimen by the product, you need multiple measures. So our target is here. We want to achieve single shot phase imaging with a large specimen by the product. And our method is related to diffractive imaging, so I would like to talk about diffractive imaging briefly. And this is the schematic diagram of diffractive imaging. And the object is illuminated with coherent light, and propagating field from the object is captured with the image sensor without reference light, and also imaging optics. And here, the lowercase f is the complex amplitude of the object view, and the capital F is the Fourier transform, and G is the complex amplitude on the image sensor. And as I mentioned, image sensor just observes intensity only. We lose the phase. So our measurement is absolute square. Then this is our form. And this inverse problem is known as phase retrieval. And this equation can be written like this. And in this case, the second term can be considered as the optical transfer function, OTF. And if your object is from nature, your OTF has a strong peak around the frequency area, and the high frequency components are quite weak. So it means the condition of the mass problem in diffractive imaging is quite bad. So we want to improve the condition of the phase retrieval. And the typical approach to improve the condition of the phase retrieval is a useful mask. This mask is known as support. And this mask N is multiplied with the object field. And then the OTF is calculated with the convolution of the Fourier transform of the object and Fourier transform of the mask pattern. So it means the aperture size of your mask is very, very small. Fourier transform of the mask pattern spreads over on the frequency domain. Then the OTF is flattened and the convolution of the phase retrieval is improved. But in this case, your object must be very, very small. So we used another approach. We used a randomized population on the object field, like a presentation in that pedestal. And the randomizer field arc is multiplied with the object here. And then you are what you the decomposition of the Fourier transform of the object and the Fourier transform of the random pattern. And the Fourier transform of the random field also spreads around the frequency domain. Then you got the pattern and the condition of the phase retriever in the field. So we used the randomized refraction to achieve pattern here. But we have another issue to solve. Our measurement is intensity only. On the other hand, our target is complex amplitude and the phase. So this reconstruction process is reinforced. Then we applied the compressive sensing algorithm for the reconstruction. So we can achieve single shot diffractive imaging with a wide field of view. And this randomized diffraction can be implemented with structural elimination, or you can use the coded aperture too. So I'll show an experimental demonstration. And we implemented the coded aperture with a special lighting grid. And the target is oriented aurora on the slide glass. And these are experimental demonstrations. This is the binary amplitude mask. And the transmission factor was 70%. And this is the captured intensity image. And these are reconstructed amplitude in the phase from this captured intensity image. And this is an image taken by a convolutional microscopy. So we achieve single shot phase imaging with a wide field of view without device. And we also extend this concept to the major case. In this case, we use a diffuser to generate three-dimensionally structured random elimination. And the three-dimensional object is modulated by the three-dimensional randomized structured elimination, and the scattered light from the object is captured with the image sensor without reference light. And in this study, we supposed vertical scattering model in the reconstruction process. Okay, so I'll show our experimental demonstration. The target is a box, which is a spherical coordinate origin. And this is the captured intensity. And we reconstructed six layers of amplitude and six layers. Six slices of phase from this single captured image. And the slice pitch was 30 microns. And as I mentioned, there is no mechanical movement during the measurement in this method. So we can apply this technique to real time imaging of dynamically moving target like this. And in this case, the frame rate was 6.3 frames per second. And also we performed a single pixel phase imaging. And this is the setup of a single pixel diffractive imaging. In this case, we used multiple measurement with different coding patterns on the spatial light modulator. And randomized the field, the intensity of the randomized field on the single pixel detector is measured many times with different quality patterns displayed on the spatial random data. Okay, so I'll show experimental demonstration. The target is already aurora on the slide glass at the previous experiment. And the pixel count is 206 by 206. And the number of measurements was 7,000. this is the sample ratio about 17%. And these are constant temperature and constant pressure. And this is a microscopic image from the same area. And these were amplitudes from different numbers of measurements. Of course, if you can increase the number of measurements, you can get better results. And these are also constructed phases from different numbers of measurements. Again, you can get better results if you can increase the number of measurements. So today I talked computational imaging with randomness, and I presented learning-based computational imaging and non-learning-based computational imaging. And in the case of learning-based computational imaging, I presented visions through scattering media, object classification through scattering media, and also cytometry for sensing. And also I presented focusing through scattering media and computer-generated program for charge control. And in the case of non-learning-based computational imaging, I presented spectral correlation imaging, and also single-shot phase imaging and single-pixel phase imaging without human sight. So thank you for your attention.
Thank you, Rio, for a very nice presentation. I'd like to see if anybody wants to make a question.
How flexible is the system to the type of objects you want to see? As you were discussing yesterday machine methods. I mean, if you teach the system to recognize faces, you will work with torques, for example, or you need to teach it.
You need additional training for imaging cards.
So, even the scattering media is the same?
Yes. Yes. For example, we try this. So, for example, after the training, we displayed airplane on the special light data. So I saw a strange tattoo on the face.
I have a similar question, maybe. I understand that you do holography or you need a laser, but specifically for this example here, that's completely unnatural. Faces. Why should I use a laser and have all these coherent artifacts, decomposing noise, edge ringing, speckles? So the common way would be just have a incoherent lab. So why do you use the coherent light? Is that just to encode it by a speckle?
Yes,
would that work with the incoherent illumination as well?
If you reduce coherence of the light source, the contrast of the spectrum is also reduced. Right? It's sort of the spectrum is gone if you use white light.
But I understand you use the spectrum somehow, but nobody would try to recognize faces here with a laser. is that suited for only for photos, or can I use that with a lens? Can I use it in that room? You understand what I mean? That's
all. Is it
only for the photo, which I put in the laser? And then, of course, I understand this, but
yeah. So, actually, I don't like real problem. Okay, so this is just a toy problem. Okay, so we don't care about real application, actually. So My image is spread on special random data, and we suppose this is our target. You can try, for example, real object between the diffusers with this neural net. So this is just a trick problem.
Any more questions? I do have one. First of all, I would like to make an acknowledgement. River is really the responsible for the machine learning feeder applied to, you know, optical sensing in the latest, maybe 3 years, which has been sort of a revolution. So it's been very nice results, and I think there will be some time to see the amount of application. So in that regard, I'd like to make a question. How do you see this sort of, I don't know, I wouldn't say competition, but I mean, the results using, you know, machine learning, such as, you know, deep learning, as you have shown, I mean, are just amazing. And analytical methods, even phase retrieval, yeah, it's way harder to make it work. So how do you see these sort of trends or fight between, you know, learning-based methods and the analytical methods? How do you see the future from here?
I think Shim answered the question yesterday. So I like his approach. So it's sort of hybrid. And this is the direction which we should follow.
All right. Let's thank Rio again. Thank you so much.